parents couldn't afford it. And so for the next 2 years, as we went through the trial process, he was in jail awaiting his sentencing. And I have to say, when we went to go to trial, I was glad that he had whatever change of heart he had, because instead of going through a trial, the morning of trial, he changed his plea to guilty. And at that point, the judge had to sentence him under Florida law, and he was sentenced to 44 years in prison for 4 counts of DUI manslaughter. He was not charged for anything for the injuries to his cousin. He has to serve 85% of that sentence, so he will be there until his 50s. And I'd like to say the little things I know about him. You know, he went to high school, he graduated from high school, he was in community college, he taught drums to kids because he'd been a drummer in high school. You know, he lived at home. This was not a kid who was really a super troubled kid. But he was, the family said, using alcohol and pot to make himself feel better after the recent death of his grandmother, and making some really poor decisions. And unfortunately, that one moment of poor decision had a very large ripple effect. You know, my 2 grandchildren lost their dads. I lost my husband and my sons, my family. It's just gone. Everyone deals with grief very differently, and so there were ripple effects through the rest of the family and through friendships. And it's, you know, it's not an easy road. That's why I like to come and talk and share our story, even though it's difficult, because I really don't want anyone else to be anywhere near the same position. You know, I want you, everyone, to survive and be healthy and whole. Just a few facts, and I know I think the class has had some of these up too. Just make a plan before you go out, whatever that is. You're staying at the friend's house overnight. You know, you can sleep in your car somewhere. Taxi, Uber, Lyft. There's another one called Be My DD. And in some parts of the, not in Orlando, but in other parts of the state and other states, there's a one called Steer Clear. They come and pick you up. There are some that will come and pick you up with your car, so your car gets home with you, which I know is often kind of a deal breaker when people make that decision to get in their car and drive. Share how you feel about this with others. I know of at least one story where I've talked to offenders, and a young lady was moved, and she started telling others, and the story actually came back to me through another mom who had lost her son in another crash. So that really does help spreading the word. Talk to kids in your life. MAD calls April 21st Power 21 Day. At MAD.org, you can get free things to talk to middle school or high school kids in your life or share with your families. You can download the materials, and it just kind of helps parents know kind of the outline of how to get to the point when they don't really know how to have this uncomfortable conversation. As sometimes we have many uncomfortable conversations to have with our kids. And lastly, I just want to ask you to treat others with compassion. People are not always aware of the hidden hurts in your life. I know whenever I share this story, it's not unusual for someone to tell me that they know someone who's been in a drunk driving crash, or they've lost a child in another way. You know, we carry a lot of things inside us that people don't know about. And so just, you know, as you go through your life, think about that when people maybe react funny, or they, you know, you have kind of a weird feeling about somebody. You know, just don't assume. Try to just take that high road and say, you know, maybe they're suffering and you just don't know what it is. Okay. So now I'm going to hand it over to Rabbi Kay.
So let me first introduce our religious speakers. I want to thank Amy for her bravery and her story, something that we can definitely learn from. So I'm going to introduce each of our speakers together before we start with the first. Rabbi Kay, Rabbi David Kay, is a graduate of the Jewish Theological Seminary of America, where he received both rabbinic ordination and a Master's of Arts degree in Jewish education. He serves congregation Ohev Shalom in Maitland. Born and raised in Chicago, he received his Bachelor of Science degree in Ecology, Ethology, and Evolution from the University of Illinois. After college, he worked in various jobs, ranging from biological research technician to preschool teacher before returning to his teenage vision of becoming a rabbi. During the nearly 20 years between graduating college and entering rabbinical school, he played music solo with a collaborative and an original band. He returned to the organized Jewish community through involvement in the Synagogue of the Deaf in suburban Chicago. Always passionate about civil rights and social justice, Rabbi Kay has been engaged in interfaith activities, including the Catholic-Jewish Dialogue Group of Collier County, Florida, and the Interfaith Council of Central Florida, through which he has been honored to help coordinate the annual interfaith observance of Martin Luther King. Our next speaker is Pastor James Coffin. He's executive director of the Interfaith Council of Central Florida, brings to his current role a diverse life experience. Mr. Coffin grew up on a farm in Missouri. After graduating from high school, he spent a year as a church volunteer in Mexico. He earned a degree in theology at New Bold College in England and was later ordained as a minister for the Seventh-day Adventist Church. During his ministerial career, he worked in both the United States for 26 years and Australia for 10 years. In addition to residing overseas for extended periods, he has traveled extensively in Europe, Asia, and the South Pacific. Pastor Coffin spent 9 years of his pastoral work in youth ministry and 9 years as an editor of the Adventist Church publication. His last 18 years before assuming his current role, he served as senior pastor of the Markham Wood Church of Seventh-day Adventist in Longwood. He has authored 3 books dealing with the theory about practice of and questions arising from religion. He has written scores of articles for religious publications and websites, and he has had some 50 My Word opinion pieces printed in the Orlando Sentinel, usually addressing religious and social ethical issues. He and his Australian wife have been married for 36 years and have 3 grown sons. Last but not least is Imam Muhammad Musri. He's the president and senior imam of the Islamic Society of Central Florida, which includes 10 mosques, a full-time school, K-1 through 12, a childcare center, a social services organization, and an interfaith outreach department, which provides hospital and prison chaplains and partners with various faith communities to promote peace and respect among all people. He served for 4 years as the co-chair of the Interfaith Council of Central Florida. Imam Musri has a weekly radio station called The Three Wise Guys with Rabbi Engel and Reverend Fulwider. So he's one of the three wise guys and is regularly interviewed by local national and international TV, radio, and print media. Imam Musri is a regular lecturer on Islam, Islamic law, and the culture of the Middle East at various colleges and universities. He was first appointed by Governor Jeb Bush as a member of the Florida Governor's Faith-Based Advisory Council and was reappointed by Governor Charlie Crist, as well as for the Governor's Complete Count Committee for the 2010 census for the state of Florida. So help me welcome all of our speakers, and we'll have Rabbi Kay join us.
Pleasure to be here and appreciate the invitation. Since we're all in college, I'm going to start with a physics lesson. Sorry. Imagine if you have a one-ton piece of metal which is traveling at 55 miles per hour. Now you have mass and acceleration. That gives you an idea of just how much force is being generated when you're driving an automobile. Fortunately, I took a year of physics in high school before I got my driver's license. Once I did that calculation and saw how much force there was and how much I would have to stop and how much I have to steer through the streets of Chicago, I did get my license. It didn't scare me away from my license, but it turned me into a very cautious driver because I realized exactly what it was, that I was moving through groups of people. Yeah, there were other people who were surrounded by walls of metal too, but I knew roughly what the tolerances of those pieces of metal were, And the first time that I, you know, that I backed into a pole in a parking lot and saw what going 7 miles per hour and just gently bumping something, what it could do to the trunk of my parents' car, that was not very much force at all. The other one wasn't even moving, right? So it was really, and it was really driven home to me. I had only been driving about a year, and I was going down the street, just pulled away from my own house. And it just so happened that we parked on the wrong side of the street, facing the wrong way, really, in front of our house. But the way I came in, you know, everybody just did that habitually. So I was pulling away from the curb, and this is how long ago it was that I was doing this. The car didn't have an FM radio. So I had a portable radio sitting on the passenger seat. And as I was pulling away from the curb, I bumped the antenna. That's really how long ago it was. And so I leaned over to adjust it for just a split second, and when that happened, I veered to the right, and the right front corner of my parents' car bumped, and I was going less than 10 miles an hour, bumped in the middle of the radiator of a neighbor's car and caved it in. At that point, I said to myself, I don't ever want to be in a position where I'm driving a vehicle and I'm not in full possession of my judgment, because that was pretty poor judgment to begin with, and you can imagine if you know, if you further impaired that poor judgment, that I would really be dangerous on the road. I want to address this topic from the perspective of my faith tradition, and one of the overarching principles in Judaism. In Hebrew, it's called pikuach nefesh. It means the preservation of life. And that's an overarching concept in every faith tradition, is the centrality, the sanctity of life. How that plays out is going to be more or less the same in, I think, in every faith tradition and philosophy, that we don't devalue human life. But let me just give you a few specifics, and then I have a closing point I'd like to make as well. The first one is the question of alcohol to begin with. Mine is not a tradition which says that that alcohol is something that you abstain from. In fact, there's a rabbinic teaching, there's a Talmudic teaching that says the best way to celebrate something is to have wine, because wine gladdens the heart. But you have to put that in its historic context. Wine, in the ancient usage, could be anything from kind of what we know as wine today, although most wines, by the way, and even though they have a comparatively low alcoholic content compared to distilled alcohol, most wines have been needled. That means if they have a 10-11% alcohol content, that's because alcohol's been added to them. So in the ancient world, you had wine that was maybe 6 or 7% alcohol by volume, kind of where many beers are. But it ranged everything from what was called new wine, which was essentially grape juice, to fermented wine, which was then diluted with water, because it had a very strong flavor. It wasn't, we didn't go through all the processing. It wasn't filtered and all that kind of stuff. So even though, yes, the Bible says that wine, and by the Bible I mean the Hebrew Bible, gladdens your heart, that doesn't mean you're supposed to drink. At all necessarily, or certainly not to excess. Because set against that is the tradition, a very strong biblical tradition, of preserving and protecting and defending your personal health. And it was known in the ancient world, and we certainly know today, we certainly document it, the physical, setting aside for a moment the issue of impaired driving, or boating, or ski-doing, or whatever else he happens to be doing, there's the health impact on you, right? I mean, if you stop to think about it, something which, which makes you dizzy and impairs your judgment is probably not necessarily something which is good for you physically when you stop to think about it. I mean, if you just got out of bed one day and you said, man, I feel really dizzy and guilty and I'm making bad decisions, you would figure that you must be sick and you need something to... you need to go back to bed, not let's jump in the car and pick up my friends. The other concept that I want to touch on, though, is One which is emphasized again and again in the Torah, the primary sacred text in Judaism, which is the responsibility that we have for the consequences of our actions. We are held accountable, according to Jewish tradition, for whatever it is that we do. And the rabbinic tradition that comes later actually expands on this. And there's a teaching that says, whatever it is that you do, you're responsible for the consequences, whether you intended it or not, whether you were awake or asleep. Right? So think about it. If you're sleeping and, you know, your arm flings out and you knock over, let's go to the ancient world, you knock over a candle and you start a fire. No, you didn't deliberately start a fire, but the fire started because of something that happened through you. You have some level of responsibility. And that's the thing which is emphasized. So whatever it is that you choose to do, you're not just choosing for yourself. You're choosing for others as well. And that brings me to the last concept I wanted to touch on, which is that of the responsibility of so-called bystanders. People say, what can I do? What can I do to stop this? Or I couldn't do anything to stop it. Yeah, you probably could. You have responsibility too. Just because it isn't you doing it doesn't mean you don't have an obligation to be part of that. And that includes those people who serve the alcohol. If I'm selling drinks at the bar, and in my band days, I tended bar as well. If I'm playing drinks at the bar, yeah, I want to sell as many of those as I can. But I also have a responsibility. These days, I have a legal liability, but even back in those days, I have a responsibility to think about how is this guy getting home? This guy is completely wrecked, and he comes back and he wants more drinks. So, either I sell him enough that he can't stand up at all, or I have to say to myself, buddy, how are you getting home? Because you're not getting into your car. And even if I don't have a legal responsibility or a liability responsibility because I don't want to get sued, I've got an ethical and a moral responsibility to say, give me the keys, and we'll make sure somebody gets you home. So something which in Amy's presentation, which was very touching, and I appreciate and thank you so much for sharing your personal story with us. Something which struck me, and is always in the back of my mind, and I haven't said in public, but now I think is a good thing to close with, is that I think we all look forward to the day when we don't have to name any more laws after the victims of whatever it is that people did. So I appreciate your attention. Thank you.
If I were to ask how many of you expect to be arrested for a DUI, probably not many of you are going to raise your hand and say, oh yes, I plan to do that tonight or next week or whatever it might be. And if I were to ask you how many of you expect to do something really horrendous while under the influence,